Hello everyone, in this video we will see the 8086 bus timing. For the bus cycles, so what do you mean by bus cycle is the transaction for a read or write, what is the timing that is involved, that we call it as the bus cycles. So the length of cycle is 1 through 4 clock cycles. So here this represents the clock cycles T1, T2, T3, T4. So it involves 4 T states or 4 clock cycles. We see the clock signal is nothing but a square wave. Since it has got rise time and fall time, it is mentioned or depicted like this. It may include one or more intermediate wait states. So in this figure, so this state is a wait state. So if the memory or peripheral is slow, it will respond slowly with the use of ready signal, introducing an additional wait state. So if it is too low, it may introduce another wait state also. So if you see here, this T1 represents the idle state between bus cycles. So first there is a bus cycle T1 to T4, another bus cycle T1 to T4. So this period indicates the idle state between two bus cycles. So now we will see the notations in the timing diagram. So this is the clock signal that we have seen already. Next, this represents the signal levels and transition. So this indicates a high level, this indicates a low level, this indicates a high to low transition, and this indicates a low to high transition. Sometimes there used to be shaded area in the signals, so this indicate that this signal may transit from high to low within this period of time any way from here to here. Next we will see the bus notations. So if you see here, there are T3 clock cycles, T1, T2 and T3. So during T1 we have 4 signals, A3, A2, A1, A0. Assume these are all address signals. So, and during T2 it is 0100, during T3 it is 1001. So if it is going to be 16 lines, we need to find out all these lines and then calculate the address. So instead of that, a simple notation using this parallel lines. So here during T1 it indicates 0AH. Here H stands for the hexadecimal. So 0 stands for 0000 binary, A stands for 1010, corresponding to these 4 values. So instead of depicting each and every line, a similar functionality lines can be grouped together to form the bus, which can be represented like this. So during D2 it is 04H and during T3 it is 09H. So it value a single nibble can have value from 0 to F. So here this crossover indicates there is a change in at least one of the lines. So during T2 to T3 again there is some change. So this is what is represented here, but there will be another notation wherein first represents the signal transition, whereas this represents the tri-stated or high impedance state of the bus. So address bus might be tri-stated or in high impedance during some point of time, represented by this notation. So next we will see the bus timings for minimum mode configuration. In minimum mode configuration, only 8086 is the single processor and it will be interfaced with the memory or a peripheral, IO peripheral. So as we all know, the address and data lines are multiplexed. So for demultiplexing, we will have latch signal gated, the clocked by ALE signal, and the transceivers which are controlled by DEN, DT bar, R bar, data transmitter receive. So these are the lines we require. Next we will see the memory or IO read operation. So we have a memory or IO device. So to read the value, first address should be supplied by the 8086 processor, and then it should supply the read line, which is active low line, and based upon this read line, the memory or IO device will send the data in the data line. So this is how a memory read or IO read happens. So for these signals, for sending the address, we need to latch it using a ALE signal. Then for reading the data, we need to have the transceivers, which should be enabled by DEN and the direction by data transmitter receive bar, which should be active low to receive the data at the 8086. So these are the signals that are required for memory or IO read. Now, so these are the signals. So first, a clock signal is needed for timing information. Then definitely we need to supply the address. So this represents the multiplex address and data line, and then this represents the higher order address. So for demultiplexing, we require the address latch enable for the latch. Then to indicate whether it is a memory operation or IO operation, this signal is required. If it is high, it indicates a memory operation. If it is low, it indicates a IO operation. Then after supplying the address, the 8086 need to supply the read signal, which is an active low signal. Then for the transceivers, it requires for direction, data transmit or receive. For receive, this should be active low. Then the enable for the transceivers. So these are the signals that are involved for a minimum mode read operation. So next we'll see the first T cycle, or first T state, or the T1 clock cycle. So here first the address is provided. So this represents the higher order address. This is the address and data multiplex line. So to latch this address, the ALE is given. So these are the signals. These three signals are active during this cycle. And if it is going to be memory, this line is active. So this is not a bus, but this line will be high if it is a memory, or low if it is a IO operation. Next, during the T2 clock cycle, what happens is the read signal is given, and also data enable is given for the transceiver to be ready to receive the data. So read signal is active low. After receiving the read, during the T3 clock cycle, the data will be provided. So this data is supplied by the memory or the IO device, whereas the other states are maintained as such. So during the T3 cycle, data is output by the memory or IO device. During the fourth clock cycle, T4 clock cycle, this data will be read by the microprocessor during the rising edge of the read, and afterwards the other signals will be removed. So if you see here, T2 to T4, the status signal is given by the lines which are otherwise used for A16 to A19. So these are with respect to the minimum mode read operation. Then if it is going to be a memory or IO write operation, so similar to read, first the location for writing should be supplied by the 8086 processor, which is the address line. Then the data as well as the write command are given by the, so here the data is supplied by the 8086 to the memory or IO device. Since address and data are multiplex line, again for latching purpose we need to have the ALE. For the data, direction and enabling the transceivers, we require DEN and data transmitter read bar. Here data transmit, so it should be active high. Then it will be given to the memory or IO device. So similar to the read operation, all the signals are similar, except that the write operation, write signal is used here instead of the read signal, and this data transmit or receive signal will be active high. Now during the T1 clock cycle, what happens is again the address is given in all the lines, and ALE is used to latch. So depending upon whether it is a memory or IO write, this line will be either high or low. Then data enable is enabled so that the transceiver is ready to receive the data in the next clock cycle. So here during the clock D2 clock cycle, the data is given. So this data is given by the 8086 to the peripheral. And also during the second clock cycle, T state, the write signal is given. So the memory device, after receiving the write signal and data, it will process the data, and during the third cycle, it will write the data into the memory or IO device. So the same status is maintained for the peripheral to process the data. Then during the T4, first the write signal is removed, followed by removing the other signals. So data, status, all those things will be removed. So this is the timing diagram for minimum mode write operation. So first write signal is removed and then the other signals. So next, in the case of interrupt acknowledgement, if you see here, after receiving an interrupt, interrupt acknowledge will be given. So after receiving the interrupt, interrupt acknowledge will be given, and based upon the interrupt, the type of the interrupt will be given in the address for the vector interrupt to proceed. Next, the bus request and grant timing in minimum mode. So in minimum mode, hold and hold acknowledge lines are given. Say for the case of direct memory access, what happens is the DMA controller will request for the address and data bus and control bus. So the hold is a request by the other bus master asking to claiming the hold of address and data bus. After receiving the request, the hold acknowledge will be given by the, so this signal is given by the external bus master, and hold acknowledgement is the signal asserted by the 8086 giving the control to the other. So after hold acknowledge is given, 8086 relinquishes its control over the bus. Next, we'll go for maximum mode configuration. In maximum mode configuration, more than one processor are used in the system. So a bus controller 8288 is used. So for latching the data, the ALE supplied by the bus controller, and also for the transceiver, the data enable and the data transmit or receive, these signals are given by the bus controller. Similarly, for the peripherals, instead of a write and read signal from the processor, this gives memory read command or memory write command, IO read command or IO write command, and advanced signals for these peripherals. So now we'll see the maximum mode read operation. So in maximum mode read operation, what happens is during the T1 clock cycle, it gives out the address and the ALE signal is given, and during the second clock cycle, the memory or IO read signal is given. And after giving this signal, during the third clock cycle, this data is given by the peripheral. During the fourth clock cycle, it is read by the processor, and then all the status are enabled. So if you see here, whenever the data enable is given only when the data is available and the data transmit or receive. So since it is a read signal, it is going to be active low. So this is similar to minimum mode, except that the ALE memory read or IO read command, data transmitted receive, and then data enable. These signals are produced by the bus controller and not the 8086, because since more than one processor are there, these signals are controlled by the centralized bus controller. Okay. Next, similarly, for the maximum mode write operation, so here for read operation as well as for write operation, the status signals are checked to see whether it is by the bus master. Then similarly, for the write operation, the status signals are monitored, and then first the address is given, ALE is given by the 8288 to latch the address. Then the write command, then the data is given, and during the third clock cycle the IO write or memory write command is given, and then the next last clock cycle the signals are removed. Here we have an additional signal called advanced memory write command or advanced IO write command. So this signal is given by the bus master for one clock cycle in advance to the write command, so that the peripheral may be ready to process the data that is received from the bus controller or the bus master. Then the interrupt acknowledge is similar to minimum mode, except that the lock signal will be asserted so that during the current cycle the buses are not relinquished. Now coming back to the bus request and grant timings in maximum mode, if you see here, this signal bus request or grant, okay, so since it is going to be more than one processor in the system, first a coprocessor or another processor will request for the bus to take hold of the address and data bus, and so that it can use it for processing. So whenever a request is given is asserted by the other processor, the 8086 will provide a grant in the same line by asserting a pulse. So first pulse is a request from the other processor, the second pulse is a grant, this is by the 8086 processor, so that the other processor can use the bus for its operation. During those period, after giving the grant, the 8086 cannot use its external bus, which are all tri-state, which could be tri-stated. Then when it can use the bus, it is provided by the other coprocessor or the other processor using the again a pulse in the same line. So this is a request grant line. So first pulse is a request from the other processor, second pulse is a grant by 8086, the third pulse is again releasing the bus by the external processor. So this is with respect to bus requests and grant timings in the maximum mode. So in summary, what you have seen is, for any bus operation it requires 4 clock cycles. Sometimes it may include additional wait states for slower peripherals. So we have seen the timings for read, write, interrupt and request and grant for minimum mode and maximum mode operations.